Ask only for the circumstances surrounding a relationship. Ask for an honest and faithful partner. Never ask for a specific individual to be honest and faithful. You cannot determine what others are to have or how they are to be have. That is a breach of universal law. It is a dangerous practice. You certainly wouldn't like it if someone tried to run your life for you. We must each choose our own life for ourselves. This is the responsibility of every individual on the face of the earth. We do not have the right to interfere with anyone's personal growth. If you do try to control someone else, to decide what is best for them, you may be asking for more trouble than you care to have. The best idea is to concentrate on your own growth and let others take care of their own lives. You may, however, ask that you know how and where a particular individual fits into your life. Right, I now know how and where John fits into my life. Here you are asking for information about your life. And you are leaving John to deal with his own life. Draw the boundaries and let the universe fill in the details. I need to say a word about divorce. My parents got divorced when I was 9 years old. I have suffered emotional scars from their divorce. Maybe it made me a better person, I do not know. I know it took a lot of therapy to realize their divorce was not my fault. And I know I always worked a little harder to keep my own marriage together because I had seen divorce up close and personal. Natu Rally, I am not an advocate of divorce. Diane and I just celebrated another wedding anniversary last July and we earned the wonderful party our kids put together. On the other hand, some marriages are not meant to be. I know a beautiful, energetic and vivacious woman who was married to an absolutely negative individual. After 1 hour in their home, my whole family encouraged her to get divorced. He was physically and emotionally abusive. There is no excuse for that. Even more importantly, there was no excuse for raising their two children in that relationship. He might have been doing the best he could for him, but she could do better for herself. She did get divorced and found a great job where she met a new man who treats her like a queen and loves her kids. She sent us an email the other day saying that they had just received loan approval on the house they are buying together. It is her first house and she can now have a few things she never had before, like a garden and a kitty. Trust God to guide you in heavy matters like divorce. Ask for His aid and assistance. Ask for His guidance. You will see the truth and you will know what to do. Hopefully, you will not have to deal with this problem, but things happen. If you are not meant to be with someone, your situation could change very quickly. Ask that you have the correct relationship for you. Not the perfect relationship. We live in an imperfect world. In fact, that is the whole point of this life, to grow toward perfection. Everybody makes mistakes. Everybody has lessons to learn. Everybody and everything in this big, beautiful world is a bundle of imperfection. Trees grow crooked. Animals mutate and evolve. People are always less than perfect. To ask for the perfect relationship is to ask for the impossible. There is no such thing. We live in a bubbling stew that constantly changes. Change, not perfection, is the only constant in this life. Ask for the correct relationship. The universe will smile on you. If you are married or already in a serious relationship, you may want to work on this part together. Do not, however, force your significant other to join you if he or she is not interested. It is against spiritual law to tell someone else what to do. You are creating a unity, a oneness, a mariage that will serve as your fortress of well-being. Your union will create an existence which is greater than the combination of two individuals. Just remember to remain individuals while writing down this relationship. Again, write the circumstances surrounding the situation. Avoid naming specific individuals. Let the creative forces of life work for you. You do not have to do it all. If you find that a relationship is over, end it lovingly. As difficult as that sounds, always end a relationship without anger or resentment. All this means is that the law of attraction is lifted from you. Your relationship has served its purpose. You both have other things to learn, places to go, people to meet. Part friendly, if not friends. Anger and resentment will not help you on your journey. They are a heavy burden that will weigh you down, hinder your progress, and can even keep you from finding your correct partner. Now that you have detailed your marriage, write down the other relationships in your life. Skip a few pages and write "my friends" at the top of a page. Now, write down exactly what you want in relationships with your friends. Repeat this process for my customers, my business associates, my partners, my employers, my vendors, my clients, my employees. You get the idea. Always ask that only those who are for your highest good be allowed in your life. Do not ask that you be for their highest good. Again, this is against spiritual law. You are in this life to develop yourself. You are here to learn and grow. Your job is not to develop anyone else, just you. Consequently, you must be around like-minded individuals to survive. If someone you care about is very negative, you might be for their highest good, but they might not be for your highest good. Once you ask that everyone in your life is for your highest good, things will change. People who are not for your highest good will drift away from you. Let them. You will find new friends and new relationships. You will wake up one day and discover you have a new set of friends. Friends that are closer and better for your life. Some of your old friends may stay close. Others may come back later. The universe has a way of making life easy if you let it. Now that you have a feeling for how to write down relationships, do yourself a huge favor. Take some time and write down the rest of your life. Define, in broad brush strokes, the circumstances surrounding the rest of your life. Describe the kind of life you want to live. Do you want to be a parent? Do you want to live in the security of a small town? Or would you feel more comfortable riding the adventure of big-time corporate America? Do you want to travel? Do you want a nanny for your children? Would you rather have a home-based business and enjoy your kids full-time? You can have whatever you want. The sooner you define your life, the easier it is for the universe to create it for you. Plan ahead and avoid roadblocks. You have heard this all your life. Now is your chance to do some real planning. Write down the jobs or businesses you want to have. Write down the kind of client, employee or employer relationships you want to have. It is all yours for the asking, and the sooner you ask, the easier your life will become. Eventually, you will overcome all roadblocks. Life is meant to be easy and effortless. Rich is a state of mind. Nothing is impossible for the universe. Go for the biggest brass ring you can think of. Then, get enthusiastic. If you want a mansion, write down a mansion complete with butler, gardener, and cook. Get one of those magazines filled with pictures of dream homes. If you want a yacht, ask for the biggest and prettiest one you can imagine. Visit a yacht club. Maybe you want a 200-acre ranch with a landing strip. Get a map and some travel brochures of the area you like the most. Familiarize yourself with affluent lifestyles. It costs you nothing, and it tells the universe to go to work. This is your life. Get excited. The possibilities are limited only by your desire. Stretch your mind. Unbridle your imagination. Reach for the stars. It is this striving for your greatest possible good that allows you to grow. You're protected. The universe will give you what's best for you in the end. But unless you reach beyond your current material situation, you will not grow to meet your spiritual destiny. And it is, after all, your spiritual growth that allows you to become rich beyond your wildest dreams. Chapter 10. Top Secret. Congratulations. You have taken a huge first step. You have written down a number of things you want to have in your life. As you think of other things you want to have, write them down anytime. You really only need to write something down once. The universe keeps great records. You will, however, think of more details as time goes on. Moreover, it is essential that you continue to detail your life's desires if you want your prosperity to grow. You must continually create a bigger and better success story. Every new success is simply the foundation for a greater one. You are an unlimited creative being. Why stop with a car, a house, or a mate? Reach for your notebook and write on a regular basis. Your 79-cent notebook is your blueprint for success. Use it often. I keep my current one open on my desk at work. Simply glancing at the pages of my desires helps stimulate their creation. You do not even have to read them, although you can. I just turn the pages and my subconscious goes to work. No one, however, comes snooping around in my office. If you do not enjoy that kind of privacy, keep your 79-cent notebook where no one will see it but you. The things you have written down are for your eyes only. And for good reason. People who do not understand this system of working are often skeptical, even cynical. Their conscious and even unconscious feelings can generate negative reactions toward your success. Remember, we are all connected subconsciously. If someone were to read your book, they might feel jealous or angry that you have the courage to ask for the kinds of things they themselves long for. If they do not understand, they may feel obligated to straighten you out. Show you the awful truth, reality, as they see it. This is exactly the wrong kind of energy to have surrounding your blueprint for success. Even people who do understand this system of gaining wealth, and there are many more of those folks every day, even these enlightened souls, have no business knowing your thoughts and plans. Their subconscious thoughts can affect you without their knowledge. Yes, our subconscious connects us to the creative power of the universe. It also connects us to every other human being on the planet. See the diagram on page 71. What this means is that someone who knows your plans can merely think subconsciously and it affects you. Imagine that you and your wife plan a trip to Hong Kong and you tell two good friends. Outwardly, they both praise and support you. Unfortunately, their subconscious may work against you. One friend may have been in Southeast Asia under less than friendly circumstances and subconsciously thinks your plan is dangerous. Your subconscious receives the message, "Do not go to Hong Kong, it is dangerous." The other friend may want to take a vacation herself, but not to Hong Kong. She wants to go to Egypt and see the pyramids. Your subconscious receives the message, "Do not go to Hong Kong. It is the wrong place to go." Before you know it, you and your wife start feeling uneasy about your trip. Maybe, you say, "It is not a good time to get away." And you cancel your trip to Hong Kong because your subconscious received messages from your friend's subconscious feelings. This is your life. Treat it with loving kindness and divine protection. Keep the things you want top secret. One of the best reasons to keep your preferences a secret is that you actually speed up their realization. You guarantee that you get what you want faster with a higher degree of accuracy. Imagine that your desire, your creation, is a giant balloon filled with helium, spiritual energy. Once full, this balloon will carry you safely and quickly to the reality you desire. If it is a car you want, you will get it sooner. If it is a loving, harmonious relationship, you will have it now rather than later. Your act of writing down your desires has created this balloon. It has some helium in it, but not enough to get you where you want to be. Creation fills the balloon with more helium every day until it is large enough to carry you to your goal. Now, when you talk about your desires, when you share your intimate life design with anyone else, guess what happens? You let a little gas out of the balloon. Every time you say, "I am getting a new car," more helium escapes into the cosmos. Every time you say, "I am getting married very soon," pissed, more of that precious lift is gone. Right? Keep quiet and reap the rewards. As a rule, I have no idea what my wife, Diane, has written down, unless it involves me. She has no idea what I have written down, unless it involves her. If we want something we will use in common, like a new house, a vacation or our relationship, then we must cooperate and communicate, or we might end up in different houses and on separate vacations. Use your common sense. Keep in mind that this information is top secret. For your eyes only. You only need to write things down once, then glance at your list occasion ally. The idea is not to ignore your desires once written, but to detach from them. You create what you want to have on paper, then you let the universe manifest it. You still want what you want, so it does not hurt to look. Just do not dwell on how or when you will get what you want to have. Remember, God provides by means over which we have no control. Define the parameters of your desire, and let the forces of creation do the work. This is the essence of success. This is the door to getting rich beyond your wildest dreams. Chapter 11. Detachment. Once you have written down what you want, you have a new challenge. It is called detachment. We touched on this previously. Detachment is the process of giving up what you want to the universe. You decide what you want. You write it down, you visualize, you get excited, then you detach. You stop caring about getting what you have asked for. That does not mean that you no longer want what you asked for. You still want it. But in your heart, you must not care if you get it or not. If it comes, it comes. If not, be happy with what you do have. Always be happy with your current situation. Unless you detach yourself from the things you ask for, you will not get them. I know it sounds strange. It is one of the most difficult concepts to explain, let alone do. Yet detachment is the door through which you get everything you ever wanted. Once you have had any experience with a two-year-old, you know exactly what detachment means. Take a two-year-old to any store and let her walk next to you. What happens? I guarantee you, sooner or later she will take off running the other way. At first, you take up the chase. You are going to catch that child and grab her hand. But guess what? Two-year-olds are fast and quick. Even if you do catch her, your success is only temporary. That ball of energy will scream and kick until you let go so she can run away again. Your little prize is playing chase me. This is not a game adults can win. At some point, hopefully, you learn detachment. When the child runs one way, you go the other and never look back. Bingo! Your two-year-old will quickly stop running away from you. In short order, she will come running back to find you. This is exactly what you must do once you have written down what you want. Turn away, and the things you ask for will come running to find you. God is the source of all your good. He is also the ultimate decision maker. If He decides you aren't ready for something yet, you won't get it. If He decides you need to wait for a few months or years, you wait. You can work your rear end off for quite a while and not get the thing you are asking for. Then when you least expect it, wham! It is yours. Why? Because you finally detached. You stopped feeling responsible for acquiring it. You stopped looking for it. You stopped worrying about it. You stopped trying to secure it by your own ability. You stopped playing chase me. You, ultimately, stopped caring about having it. God said, "Ask and ye shall receive." He did not say, "Ask and then go get it yourself." To receive means it is coming to you. You do not have to go catch it. Delivery is included at no additional cost to you. The universe has an amazing distribution system. I know this must sound strange, but it is absolutely the truth. We all grew up hearing that the early bird gets the worm. The truth is, all birds get worms. The universe has an abundance of worms. You do not have to make any special effort to receive what you want. Ask and you will receive. It is as simple as that. List plus visualize plus enthusiasm equals getting what you want. When you do not detach, you are telling God that you can do it by yourself. He then waits for you to do it yourself. At the very least, this puts you in the position of cleaning your house before the cleaning lady comes. Or cutting the grass just before the lawn guy gets there. Why take on all this extra work when God has agreed to do it for you? Ask and ye shall receive. By relying on your own efforts, you will not attain anything close to what you asked for. The difficulties you must overcome when relying on your own abilities and resources are immense. Imagine yourself trying to empty the ocean one cup at a time during a rainstorm. Individual AC accomplishment is an overrated value. In truth, we do not earn, achieve, accomplish or attain anything except by the grace of the universe. Why fight this battle? Because your mother or your father told you to put your nose to the grindstone? Work hard and make a good life for yourself? Okay, work hard, put your nose to the grindstone. I am going to Disneyland. Write down what you want to have. Think it through. It is work creating a life. Get pictures of the things you want. Visualize your car, house, vacation. Get excited. Feel like it is already yours. Get enthusiastic about enjoying whatever it is you have asked for. Then, do the smart thing. Detach yourself. Turn your back and let the universe take over. Want what you asked for, but stop caring if you ever get it. This is an effortless process. Now, detachment does not mean that you quit living. Just because you don't do the work, doesn't mean you don't go to work. You continue to go about your life. You continue to take ACT on. The difference is now your actions are guided by the powers of the universe. Listen to your heart and you will know what turns to take, what roads to follow. Watch for opportunities. Doors will open and you will feel good about walking through them. This is the universe guiding you. You live your life as you did before you wrote your list. Only now you have all the power of the universe behind you. Guiding you. Protecting you. Making clear your path. The first time I used this system, it worked for me. I received in one weekend a new house exactly as I ordered it, the movers to move us there, a new car and a new refrigerator. I had forgotten completely that I had written these specific things down only 6 weeks earlier. A week after we moved in, it dawned on me that I had received exactly what I had asked for. I showed my wife for the first time what I had written. We looked at each other with one of those, "You don't think this really works, do you?" kind of looks. See, it does not matter if you have absolute faith in this system or not. The system flat works. Fortunately for me, after I wrote down what I wanted, I gave it up to God. These were things I wanted. I never stopped wanting them. We were looking at houses when we found ours. I just wasn't expecting it. In fact, we found our house quite by accident. Let things come to you. Look, but do not think you are going to conquer it by yourself. My daughter looked for an apartment for 2 months. Diane and I were constantly encouraging her to look. Have you looked today? Maybe you should try over there. There still is a little daylight left. We were anxious for her to have her own space. She finally found her apartment while coming back from the mall, where she went to forget about looking for an apartment. Traffic was bad, so she turned down a street she never traveled, and there before her young eyes was her new home. She stopped right then and talked to the manager, and within 2 days she had agreed to a lease. In nature, the universal intelligence allows birds to thrive, grass to grow and fish to flourish, all without any special effort. The earth itself spins and circles the sun with no help from humankind. Nature prospers easily and effortlessly. Humans are part of that ecosystem. We, too, are destined to prosper easily and effortlessly. Write it down, visualize, feel enthusiastic, then detach. Before you know it, many good things will be coming your way. These are the keys to that powerful force that gives you what you want in life, making you rich beyond your wildest dreams. Chapter 12. Focus on abundance. Everyone knows that the journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. Well, you have taken that first step and your journey has begun. This is not a quick fix or instant karma. You will learn and grow significantly if you are to acquire the state of wealth you desire. Here are a few guideposts you will need on your journey. Live for today. Forget all the nonsense you have learned in however many years you have lived on this planet. Forget it. Many of the things you are about to learn will contradict your old school thinking. Heck, the very idea that you can get rich without any special effort is a huge contradiction of old school thinking. Living a successful life by this system requires a new mindset. Focus on abundance. Think positively. Speak positively. Write positively. Believe in your success, and success will follow. Remember, everything is cause and effect. You have a powerful new life ahead of you. You cannot afford the luxury of the dark side of life. Negative thinking, resentment, revenge, anger, fear, hatred, envy, distrust, and antagonism lead to disaster. You are what you project. By allowing negative thoughts a place in your life, you set up barriers to your own good. You deny yourself the wonderful rewards that come with success and prosperity. George Lucas is a powerful example of someone who relies on his positive force to create wealth. Hollywood is famous for gobbling up young filmmakers and spitting them out in pieces. Yet George became incredibly successful. His Star Wars trilogy ranks as not only one of the most successful movie projects of all time, but as one of the most successful business projects ever. His work is totally positive. Good defeats evil in a world of amazing possibility. And although he leads us through a war of galactic proportions, there is no blood, no gore, and no shocking close-ups of horrific carnage. In an industry prone to dark thinking, Lucas has created a CTON and adventure bathed in a PG rating. Men, women, and children of all ages have enjoyed the Star Wars movies and, in the process, made George Lucas one of the richest men on this planet. So rich, in fact, he financed his 4th, 5th, and 6th Star Wars movies himself, giving him complete control to do anything he wants. You, too, can do anything you want. You can have anything you want. You can be that person you always wanted to be. Simply focus on abundance and do the work described here. It is all up to you. Close the door on your past. There is a new window open to your future. You opened this window when you took the time to write down what you want to have. Go back now and make sure you have written down everything you want. Be specific. Be thorough. Be clear and concise. Include the little things as well as the big things. Visualize having what you have written. And get enthusiastic about your success. After you have done all this, close your 79-cent notebook and detach yourself. Take the time to catch your breath and trust in the force of creation to deliver what you've asked for. As you recognize the positive effect this system has on your life, and you see the things you ask for come into your life, you will begin to build trust. Trust that the most powerful force in the universe is working for you. Ask and receive. Not ask and achieve. Notice every time you receive something on your list. This could be a small thing like a baseball cap or something as wonderful as making a new friend. Whatever it is, mark it off when you receive it. Then take a breath and relax. You don't have to do anything special to receive your good. Stay positive. Love everyone and remember that what you project is what you receive. In fact, everything comes back multiplied. Positive always wins. As you take note of how many things on your list come to you, remember this is not an accident. Nor is it a coincidence. These things come to you because you ask for them. How long does it take? However long it needs to take. At the end of this chapter, put down this book and take a breather. Think about what you've just done. Let it soak in a bit. You have taken a thought and given it form, shape, and substance. You have taken nothing but an abstract thought, your desire, and turned it into something physical, your written request. This is an amazing thing you've done. You've made something out of nothing. Think about it a while. You may only need a few moments, but take that time and absorb the impact this work can have on your life. Imagine what you can have by using this amazing system. Whether you take 20 seconds or 2 weeks, it's important that you take a deep breath and recognize how far you've come. Let me tell you why. When I was 17, I decided that I wanted to drive a truck in the summer. I wanted to drive an 18-wheeler. It was all I could think about. I didn't even consider the jobs that my friends took that summer. One sacked groceries. Another spent the summer nailing asbestos shingles to the roofs of houses. Another sold ice cream cones. But not me. I wanted to drive a truck. I didn't care that the law required you to be 18 to drive a tractor trailer rig. I was determined. I went to every trucking company in Lincoln, Nebraska, looking for a job. Most sent me packing immediately. This was a union town with plenty of healthy family men down at the union hall waiting for work. My chances were slim to none, but I kept asking. Finally, a small, independent, non-union, cartage carrier hired me to load and unload trailers. It was hard work. I weighed about 127 pounds soaking wet, and I had to move oil drums weighing over 500 pounds with only a hand truck. I went home the first day so tired I fell asleep before dinner and slept straight through until morning. I stayed with it. I was determined to drive a big truck, and I was willing to do anything that brought me closer to my goal. Every morning before I punched in, I would ask my boss if he had a truck for me today. He would always smile and say, "Not today, Tom. I think we need you here on the dock." I did that every day for 5 weeks. Then one afternoon, my boss called me to the dispatch station. He handed me a set of keys and told me to go hook up the flatbed trailer and put it into slot 7. What a piece of cake. Slots 6 and 8 were empty. This had to be the easiest backing job a truck driver could do. I was on fire. I was about to drive my first semi. I had finally, after 5 long weeks, taken the first step toward achieving my heart's desire. I was on the road to becoming a professional truck driver at the age of 17. I was ready to drive. Or so I thought. Now, if I had been paying attention, I would have no-ticked the crowd gathering in the yard. Drivers, dock workers, mechanics, even several of the office crew were out to watch me back a flatbed up to the dock. Some brought their lunch. Had I noticed, I might have asked myself what could possibly be so interesting about watching me back in a flatbed. I mean, I had watched the other drivers do it. There was nothing to it. In retrospect, I have to tell you that what was to follow was one of the most painful experiences of my life to that point. But at the time, I was so excited my feet barely touched the ground. I was the man. The truck driving man. Well, over the next 45 minutes I managed to destroy the bottom lights on the trailers in slots 5 and 9. I spun the steering wheel one way then the other. I drove forward. I backed up. I popped the clutch time and time again. I killed the engine. I started over. I tried again and again. The sweat poured off my body as the gathered crowd roared with laughter. I was the best joke of the year. The kid who would drive a truck was failing miserably. In the end, all I wanted to do was get out of that rig and go find some corner and die. I finally got the flatbed near the dock. It was at nearly a 45 degree angle. But that was as close as I had been all afternoon. I set the brakes and stumbled from the cab. My truck driving days were over. History. Yesterday's news. Those characters in the yard would have to find other entertainment. I was quitting. What the heck? I was only 17. Obviously, I had bitten off more than I could chew. I could ignore the catcalls from the crowd. I would simply walk up to Stan and quit. They needed another sacking clerk at Safeway anyway. Truck driving apparently was not my destiny. That's when Bob, 6 foot, 7 inch, 260 pound Bob, an over-the-road driver, grabbed me by the back of my neck. I tried to tell him he had the wrong guy. That I wasn't a truck driver after all. That I was off to easier pastures, but he wouldn't listen. He practically threw me into the cab of that international harvester. He closed the door and stood on the running board, looked me in the eyes and said, "Now, I'll show you how to do it. You wouldn't have paid any attention before. My guess is you have probably used up most of your ideas by now and you'll listen." With Bob's help, I had that flatbed squarely in slot 7 before the crowd could dry their laughing eyes. It is hard to digest everything at once. Learning takes time, and you just started a brand new system for acquiring wealth. Give it a chance to work for you. relax and let your body digest these new concepts while the universe goes to work. It is always a good idea to taste the fruit before you make a pie. This is exactly the way Marilyn taught me. She wouldn't tell me everything the first time, either. Consider waiting as your first exercise in detachment. How long you wait is for you to decide. The important thing is to recognize what you've learned before proceeding. This system requires a new mindset. Take a breath of fresh air and think about what you've read. You have plenty of time. You have already opened a door to a brilliant new life, and you are well on your way to getting rich beyond your wildest dreams. Intermission. 20 seconds to 2 weeks. Did you take a break? Did you reflect on what you've learned? If you're one of those who only waits 20 seconds, then you're probably ready to move forward. But first do this. Stand up. Stretch. Go get something from the kitchen. It's half time. If you are one of those who waits longer than 20 seconds ONDS, take your time. I waited 2 weeks before I started again. Penelope, on the other hand, didn't even take 20 seconds. The time is up to you. When you're ready, turn the page and go. Chapter 13. Divine Timing. By now, you may have already received some of the things you asked for in your 79-cent notebook. Ask for many things, big and small. The more you ask for, the better this system works. For some people these things come quickly, for others it takes a little longer. The reason is divine timing. I know a woman who was in her late 30s, never married and really had very little experience with men. She wanted a new car, a loving intimate relationship and a new job. 1 week after our first meeting she had precisely the car she described, with the exact terms she requested. 3 days after receiving the car, she met the man she eventually married 8 months later. Oh, she also quit her job and moved to the East Coast with her husband where she found a better paying job she absolutely loves. I was particularly amazed at the speed with which she got everything she asked for. Everything that we ask for comes in God's time, not ours. The universe responds at the correct time for all concerned. If the creative forces decide you are not ready for the things you are asking for, then you could have a bit of a wait. To help with the wait, I always include little things that I want. These things never seem to be high on the priority list, but they are things I want just the same. A wax job for my car. An oil change. A steak dinner. Little things can come quickly and often provide excellent encouragement, helping to generate the big things. Big or little does not matter to God. The little things keep your enthusiasm high, but the big things do come. Sometimes they come miraculously. Miracles are, after all, normal and commonplace. When I began writing this book, I started to have back pains. My office chair was a C. Thule, an old-style manager's chair. It looked good and was plenty comfortable when I leaned back, but leaning forward to write for long periods caused my back to hurt. I needed a chair, but I did not feel good about spending reserve money on a new, good quality task chair at that time. This went on for a few weeks until I realized that I had not asked for a new chair. I had not written down a chair on my list. Writing down what you want must be done continuously. If you stop asking for new things, you stop receiving new things. It is not necessary that you write down the same things over and over again. Once is enough. As you grow, however, you need to write down the new things that you want. I included a new chair on my list that day. After writing down my new chair, Diane and I went to lunch. On the way, we drove by an office furniture store and stopped just to see what they had. I found a chair that gave me such relief. I did not know how I could go back to my office without it. The chair was nearly $600, more than I could spend. Then, as my wife and I were trying to figure out how to make the money work, the saleswoman said, "Why don't you take that chair to your office and try it for a week or so? If you like it, you can pay for it then." I ended up trying several chairs, one after the other, until I found the right one. The miracle is, I had a comfortable chair 2 months before I had to pay for it. Plenty of time for God to give me the money. The universe knew I wanted a chair and provided it for me immediately. It was easily paid for, and it was the correct chair for me. I considered this a big request at the time and thought it might take a while before I received my request. God saw things differently. Not only did he provide me with the chair I am immediately, he provided me with the chair through a means over which I had no control. I would have never believed that a furniture store in Southern California would give me a chair to use free for 2 months without even taking my credit card imprint. But they did. Why? Because God is in charge, not us. Everything we ask for comes in God's time, not ours. Do not be discouraged if some of the things you ask for take a little longer. Then again, things you do not expect arrive sooner than you could ever have believed possible. The bottom line here is you are really not in charge. You must give up all control if these success secrets are to work for you. And if that isn't startling enough, wait till you hear the secret that guarantees your success, the number one key to becoming rich beyond your wildest dreams. Chapter 14. Guarantee your success. Until now, everything we have talked about centered on what you want to have. But as you probably already figured out, life is not as one-sided as saying, I want. I want. I want. You cannot go to the grocery store and get a week's groceries simply by telling the clerk you want these things. You do not build a long-term, loving relationship by focusing exclusively on yourself. Life is a two-way street, and there is a cost to everything. We pay for our groceries with cash, check, or credit card. We pay for our relationships by giving of ourselves. We also pay for everything we receive from the universe. One way or another, we always pay. Paying the universe is not a new concept. A few thousand years ago, people made sacrifices of lambs and cattle, giving God his portion of their wealth. Abraham, in fact, was willing to give his only son as a sacrifice. Today, we are not called upon to make quite the same sacrifices. Today, we are called upon to give money to the good spiritual work of the universe. Over the centuries, many divine teachers have come to the various peoples of the world. Abraham, Krishna, Zoroaster, Buddha, Moses, Christ, Muhammad, the Bab and Baha'u'llah have each and every one said the same thing. Give back to God a portion of what you receive. We call this tithing. Before you pay any bills, before you put money in savings or pay taxes, you owe the universe. Since all our good comes from God in the first place, it makes sense that we owe him for what he has given us. You pay the grocery store for the food you take home. You pay the hairstylist who gives you a new look. You pay the real estate agent who sells your house. God is the source of all your good. The guiding force of creation has given you everything. It has given you the food you eat, the house you live in, the livelihood that sustains your life. You owe everything you have to God. Giving back a portion of what you receive is more than good manners, it's a universal law. You owe the universe 10%.